Okay, everybody, this is Sheets, and I'm going to be going over UFC 281 from a betting perspective. Now, again, this is the second video on MMA wagering we did last week. And for those of you that absorb all kinds of betting content, whether it be sports or MMA or not MMA is in a sport, but you know what I mean. You might be used to a different way of analyzing things. What your typical bettor or betting advice tends to do is you take the line and you have an opinion that, for lack of a better description, that the line is wrong, right? I mean, if the Giants are favored by 1.5 over the Jets and you think the Giants are worth a bet, I mean, you're laying $1.05 or $1.10 or whatever, so you are betting that the line is wrong. That's what you're doing. That is your opinion. And that is essentially what sports betting is. And when it comes to MMA betting, that is exactly what most people do. You know, they'll say, boy, this doesn't feel right. XYZ minus 200, or this feels wrong, plus 170. Or based on what I know more than the public does on what's going to happen in this fight. So I feel as though I can get an edge over these lines. And I'm not saying that that's not possible. It's a little less possible in the more highly liquid sports like NFL, where you just have so much information and billions of dollars being wagered. I don't say billions, but many millions of dollars being wagered, which kind of, solidifies the line as kind of being what it should be. At least MMA is a little less liquid, so you could make the argument that the line might not be efficient. The problem is that the vig on some of these wagers is kind of tough to overcome, right? You usually have spreads of like minus 110 to minus 110, or minus 130 to plus 110, or at the bigger odds, you're getting, maybe like bigger spreads. And then when you get to these props, you don't even know what the actual odds are because you don't really see the other side of it. Like if you see XYZ in round one plus 400, you don't really get to bet on the other guy, not the other guy. You don't really get to bet not round one. I mean, that's a very illiquid market, and they probably have you lay minus 600 or something. So you don't even know what the actual chances of winning they're even implied are. I have this feeling that they just put some of those odds out just to get people to bet something where the actual odds are just have been happening or way higher. So what do you do when you believe that a market is either efficient or the vig is very difficult to overcome? What I've discovered, or what I've done over the years, and listen, we are doing this for fun, right? Yes, you are doing it to make money, but look, I mean, it's not the most profitable thing in the world to bet on stuff. Right, we're doing it to get a sweat and whatever. So if you're going to do that, you may as well try to, increase your odds or whatever. My views on betting, whether it's sports and MMA, has always been that the line reflects the sum of the intelligence and the narratives and the information processed of people betting on that wager. That makes sense, right? And that's the way I look at stocks as well, that the stock price is reflective of the overarching belief of the public that is betting or investing in that stock. All the information that people have is being interpreted a certain way by everybody and coming up with this price. So to determine whether a price is bad or a line is bad, what I like to do is think about what is going into the public's perception of that stock. What is going into the public perception of that fighter? What is going into the public perception of that fight that might not truly reflect why that price is what it is? In other words, how much of a line is based on narrative? How much of a line is based on hope? How much of a line is based on psychology than actual winning chances? And when I find that I can identify the easy narrative to tell. And it's probably the idea that the other side is the sharper line. Because if something is like a narrative-based thing or an easy story to tell or something that everybody's kind of agreeing with that's being put into that kind of financial hopper, and yet the line is still what it is, probably the opposite side of that narrative or that, you know, method of thinking is the correct side. So that is kind of the way I approach all of sports betting. There are other things I do with sports betting as well. And again, I really don't do it professionally or anything like that, not even close. But the way I analyze it is sometimes I play for letdowns. I play for spots or things like that. MMA is not exactly like that. It's a little like that. But with fighters, you have so much time between fights that it's not as if, you know, you want to bet a guy necessarily off the ceiling performance. However, you do have this element of recency bias that will go into, again, how the public comes up with a certain line. And hopefully when I kind of review my approach to these fights, it'll give you a different way of thinking about MMA, different way of thinking about sports betting in general, and whatever. So what I'm going to do, by the way, I am going to bet every fight. And that's not always the smart thing to do, right? But I just kind of believe that if I'm going to talk about a fight, I may as well bet it because I know someone's going to bet it based on what I said. So I may as well be along there with you. So I'm going to make a pick on all 14 fights, and I am going to bet all of them, and I'm going to bet all of them the same amount, just because that's what I'm going to do. You'll be right there along with me, and you'll see me actually, you won't actually see me bet them because I can't actually bet them while I'm on this recording platform, but we'll see. And I honestly don't know exactly what I'm doing yet. I'm going to talk through this as we do it, and you'll see where there are some fights that I might not even be able to get some kind of feel on, but I'm going to come up with something anyway, which I'll come back to. So let's start, I guess, with Carlos Ulberg versus Nikolai Nurmagomedov. And you know, here you have Ulberg is -130 and Nurmagomedov is +110, so that 40% big or whatever. And so what's kind of going into this fight? What is making this line what it is? So basically what the idea is that Carlos Ulberg is, you know, a much superior striker. He's very, very well built. He's kind of looks like a really good fighter. He's coming off a really, really good win. And, you know, and he's a -130 favorite. Then you have the Nicole Nurmagomedov story, which is a little different. He's kind of that wrestler grinder type, you know, where he's gonna try to bite and crawl and you know, try to get you down. He's gonna take a lot of punishment or whatever it is. So what you have here is this is what's going into this line. You have the idea that Nurmagomedov is kind of a punching bag, and I've heard that throughout the entire week. He's a punching bag, and if he's a punching bag, then Ulberg is probably, you know, that's a pretty good matchup for Ulberg, right? Because Ulberg is a high volume striker, and you know, it's something it's really good to be able to hit something right away. Even in Ulberg's loss recently, he was able to crank up a whole bunch of significant strikes before he gassed out in the third round and got finished. So stylistically, it's a really, really good matchup for Ulberg. You know, he's going to hopefully be able to pound on him. And that all makes sense, and that's kind of real. But then what I'm getting is this idea that Nurmagomedov is resilient, okay? That he's resilient, that he's a dog, you know, for whatever that is, you know? And that he's tough to kind of finish. And there's also this kind of idea that Ulberg, this is more going into this last fight, that he's a little soft, I guess. That he's not the greatest finisher in the world. So you have this idea that Nurmagomedov is going to be kind of tough to finish. However, in light of all of that, you have this under 1.5 round prop, which is really kind of getting some steam. You know what I mean? Like only -160 finishing the first round and a half. I mean, that indicates that this could finish, and that doesn't make a lot of sense considering that Nikolai is a dog, that he's very resilient. Okay, so I actually feel that there is value in Olberg actually by KO or Olberg inside the distance. I feel as though that is going to be the undervalued line. So my only question is where I want to bet this. And what I think in this particular case is that it's probably better to either bet him just to win by KO at +180/+165, or try to pick a particular round. And when I look at the round props, I see Olberg in round one is +300, and that's pretty good. The interesting one to me is the Olberg in round three. You see this like big jump from like 300 to 550 to 1000. But the problem with betting the Olberg in round three is that it's a little more conducive to that narrative, you know, that the Nigger Amiano is a dog, that he can take a lot of punishment, that he's very resilient. So I actually feel as though the best bet in this fight is probably Olberg in round one. So that is what we're going to do. We're going to play Olberg in exactly round one, and we're going to play him again. We're going to do 180 is our, oh, we can't do that again. Right. Sorry about that. Okay. We'll keep it in the bet slip. How about that? And again, afterwards, we'll get to that. Okay. Julio Arce versus Montel Jackson. All right. So what I've seen from this fight, and this is really, really sneaky, okay? And again, you see Montel Jackson's a minus 200. And I watch and I absorb daily fantasy content as opposed to betting content as well. And what I'm getting is this, that Montel Jackson is sort of untested. He's a little awkward, but he's really big and he has a reach. Okay. The other thing that I've heard is that, and I've heard a little bit too much of this, if you want to know the truth, that while he hasn't really put in that much wrestling in the UFC, he was prepping to be an Olympic wrestler. Now, after I think wrestling got canceled or something like that, but so Montel Jackson has this unproven wrestling acumen as well. Okay. And you look at the tail of the tape and you see that he's got a 5-inch reach advantage. He's like enormous for the division and all of that. And you also hear all this stuff about how huge his hands are. Okay. So you have this guy with all this wrestling upside, a guy who has the tail of the tape in his favor, and he's got these enormous hands. You would think he's like minus 800, right? He's only minus 200. Okay. So for me, the way I look at this is I think Arce he's got to have something. So I think Arce is the side at plus 170. Now it's a question of how greedy I want to get, because do I want to play him at just the plus 170 or do I want to play him inside the distance? So RSA inside the distance is plus 300. I think I want to be a little greedy and I think I want to play the RSA to win by decision. So we're going to do that. We're going to play RSA to win inside by decision at the plus 320. Okay. All right, moving on. Mike Trezano versus Sing-Woo Choi. This one to me is sort of easy as well. This fight has not been analyzed all too much from a DraftKings perspective, because you know neither fighter really has a great finishing prop, and it's not the greatest fight in the world from a finishing perspective. But one thing I will say is that of the narratives I've heard and of the takes I've had, I haven't really found much of anybody that is going to be taking Mike Trezano. You know, I would say that if I literally kept track of all of it, which I probably could have, I probably should have, I think that maybe 18 to 2 would be picking Sung Woo Choi at the minus 170 over Trezano plus the 145. And for me, I mean, he's being bet as if he's a minus 500, but he's only minus 170. So for me, I have to think that Trezano is kind of the way to go. So we're going to play Trezano plus 145 or inside the distance again. So let's just take a look. We're going to go fight lines. Fight lines, the winning method. So Trezano by decision, that's really not that much of an edge over the win prop, just the win bet. So I'm going to actually just play him plus the 145. So we're going to go plus 145. All right. Moving on, Karina Kovalkiewicz versus Silvia Gomez Suarez. So to me, this is sort of easy. You have two main narratives going on here. You have number one, that Kovalkiewicz is done. She's finished. She's on the way out. She's going to retire. And you have her in her last fight. They were saying the same thing, but she got a sub. And then they're saying, well, okay, so she'll give herself one more fight, but she has no more power. She's definitely finished. This is her on her way out. The other thing I've heard is that Silvana Gomez Juarez has all kinds of, and I love this, quote unquote, power in his hands, whatever that means, in her hands. It means that she hits hard, you know, and it means that she has some KOs if the opponent lets her hit her in the face, right? And in addition to that, you have some incredible recency bias where she just got a first round KO over Nia Liang. So you have someone who has power in her hands. You have someone who is, coming off a first round KO against someone who's on the way out. So for me, the total wrong side is not only Silvana Gomez Suarez, but also anything involving Silvana Gomez Suarez with inside the distance. I think that all of those wagers are going to be extremely overbet. So for me, I don't know. I'll just go ahead and take Kovalkiewicz on her way out. You know, my only question is do I play her by decision, or do I get really nasty and play her by submission? She did get a sub in her last fight. And part of me wants me to just kind of, without even looking, figure out what her odds should be for me to play her. But I'm already going to check. It says, boy, oh boy, Kovalkiewicz by submission plus 550. I don't know. I'm taking a lot of risk with these others. So I'm just going to lay the 110. I'm just going to lay the 110 with the woman who's washed and on her way out against the woman who has all the power in her hands. Congrats. Good. Excellent. Okay. Moving on, you have Matt Frivola against Ottoman Azatar. So this is the most popular fighter in like the entire civilized world, Ottoman Azatar. When Ottoman Azatar, look at the line movement. I mean, he started as like a plus 130 underdog or 140 underdog. It was even priced on DraftKings that way. And the entire civilized world or anybody who has a wagering account is betting on Azatar. Azatar has taken all of the steam, right? Not to mention, okay, you have Matt Frivola who this is the narrative around Matt Frivola. Matt Frivola is, they're saying, if he's going to stand and trade, you know, he's just going to get wiped out. His only chance is to maybe wrestle. And you even see, though, if you look at Twitter and you look at some quotes, they were talking, Matt Frivola was actually tweeting, no, sorry, man, I'm just going to stand and trade. And then I have other people coming out saying, yeah, Matt Frivola just can't help it. He's just going to get there and stand and trade. So all this is contributing to Azatar being this like lock play. And not only that, you have Azatar inside the distance is getting just incredible steam. So for me, I think all of that is the thing. Okay. I don't want any of Azatar. I don't want any of Azatar inside the distance. As a matter of fact, if you really, if listen, if you really want to get this right, this is what you're going to do. I don't want to say right. When I mean get it right, I mean really be on the right side of the psychology. You're going to play one of two things. You're either going to play Frivola or Frivola by decision. Okay. So let's take a look and let's see. Frivola is a plus 130. Let's say Frivola by decision, plus 400. Boy, oh boy. Frivola by decision, plus 400. Now, again, if Frivola does stand in the pocket and these guys swing wildly, this is dead, right? I don't know. It's tough. How about Frivola by submission? You know what I mean? Like, get the takedowns, then get the sub. Ooh, that's fun. I actually think this is a little bit better than the Frivola win by TKO. So for me, it's either going to be Frivola win by submission at plus 500 or just Frivola to win just for fun. Let's see what these round props are. Frivola in round three, plus 1,200. Boy, oh boy. You know what we're going to do? We're going to reduce risk just a little bit on this card. And we're going to play just Frivola plus the 180. I mean, plus the 130. Okay. Moving along. Andre Petroski versus Wellington Turman. Okay. So this is what we got. You got Andre Petroski, who is one of those Philly guys. And from Philly Gracie. Gracie Philly just basically busted everybody. Like last time their big prospect came out. Pat Sabatini was like a -2-1 favorite. He got dusted in the first round by Mike Jackson. So this is another guy coming out of here, Andre Petroski. And he's going against Wellington Turman, who's another guy that people just kind of like to hate a little bit. So you have Andre Petroski, who's still is a -195 with a very, very strong inside the distance prop. I mean, he's being priced in that, you know, in that he's probably going to get a finish. Not probably, but he's, you know, he could get a finish in a reasonable clip. But I'll tell you what's been going around the industry. I've heard the following things. I've heard Petroski's fought nobody. I've heard that he has no cardio. And I heard that Wellington Turman has what they call slick jiu-jitsu. I think he got like kind of a late arm bar in one of his most recent fights. So the cute play that everybody seems to be making is either Turman by sub or Turman in like round three or something like that. So those are the plays that will be out. What I think I'm going to do is, again, we're going to fade this cardio narrative a little bit. And we're going to say either Petroski inside the distance, excuse me, Petroski by decision, or if we want, we want to really fade the cardio narrative. We're going to say Petroski in round three. Remember, Petroski has wrestling. So it's possible that he just keeps on just getting after Thurman and Turman. Turman tries these submissions and eventually fails, and he eventually gets him in the third round. So let's take a look and see what those two lines are, either Petroski inside the distance or Petroski round three. So you have Petroski by submission plus 300. Win by decision plus 330. That's one thing to do. So it's either Petroski by decision or we're going to go Petroski in round three. So let's take a look at round three Petroski looks like. 10-1. Boy, that's going to be a hell of a sweat, right? If we do that. So take your pick, either Petroski round three, I think that's really good value, or Petroski by decision, which I also think is probably good value. Let's do Petroski by decision, plus 330. Fair enough? No, I'm not doing a six-pick parlay. Well, maybe I would, just for the hell of it. All right, okay, moving on. All right. This is where we're going to lose. So Erin Blanchfield against Molly McCann. So this is the picture that people paint, right? So Erin Blanchfield is from New York. This fight is at MSG. Molly McCann is coming over from Britain. And Molly McCann is loved in the UK and pretty much hated everywhere else. All right. So she hangs around with Patty Pimblett, you know, whatever it is. So she's coming to MSG. And you know what's going to happen? This is where we're painting this picture. And she's just going to catch a beat, right? In New York, in Madison Square Garden, with 20,000 people cheering on Erin Blanchfield. Now, that's not the worst of it. The worst of it is this. You have Erin Blanchfield, who is a expert grappler and wrestler. She dusted somebody like Sarah Alpar. But then you know what she did? She ragdolled Miranda Maverick. Now, again, I'm telling this story. She ragdolled Miranda Maverick. And Miranda Maverick just came off of a pretty dominant grappling win. Okay, she didn't finish. Pretty decent grappling win. So if Erin Blanchfield can grapple and wrestle and, you know, and ragdoll Miranda Maverick, I mean, it's pretty likely she's going to do it to Molly McCann. Well, let's just see. Like, if Molly McCann, is she prone to getting taken down? Oh, yeah, let's look. We're going to look four fights back to when she fought Laura Procopio. And when Molly McCann fought Laura Procopio, she got taken down seven times by Laura Procopio. So you have Erin Blanchfield, who's taken down Miranda Maverick seven times or whatever. And then you have, what's her name? Molly McCann, having been taken down by Laura Procopio seven times. I mean, it stands to reason that Erin Blanchfield is going to take Molly McCann to the woodshed, take her down 12 times. And this is a joke, okay? I've even heard experts wonder why this fight was even booked in the first place, you know? So that's one narrative. And that's certainly the easy one to tell. But let's just say I told a different story. Let's just say that we're looking at Erin Blanchfield. She's 23. And in her last fight, she was a minus 500 favorite against, why is her name escaping me? Whoever it is. She was a minus, well, it doesn't matter. She was a minus 500 favorite against somebody. And you know what they were saying about her as the minus 500 favorite? Well, she just came off this incredible performance against Miranda Maverick. She took her down seven times. This other person, all she's got to do is take her down seven times, and she's going to look like a minus 10,000. This is easy pickings. And you know what happened in the fight? I mean, if I'm going to keep it real, as the kids say, Blanchfield got completely outstruck in the first round. Blanchfield got no takedowns. And then in the second round, you know what? She was losing again. She got no takedowns again. And she was losing on the feet. And then Blanchfield did get a standing guillotine, a standing submission. Okay. So let's call what it is. You know, if I told you that, and then I said Molly McCann in her last three fights came off of three KOs. Okay. Or I think two of the last three fights. KOs. She actually got a takedown of her own in one. What would you think the odds would be if I gave you just that narrative? Maybe pick them, you know? So all we have is we have these two fights that are just generating all the narrative, the Procopio fight and kind of the Maverick fight. But we're forgetting about Blanchfield's last fight. We're forgetting about McCann's other fights. And I'll tell you something else about that Procopio fight. You talk about how narratives can change. Like, she had an armbar in on Procopio that Procopio didn't tap to. If she got the sub and that fight didn't exist, the thing about chaos theory, right? It's very possible that all she had to do, think about this, all that her opponent Procopio had to do in that fight was tap. And you know what happens? You fast forward, Blanchfield might be an underdog, right? I mean, maybe not, but the fact is that what has been bundled into this line, honestly, is not reflective of reality. You know what I mean? Like, people pick the things that matter and pick the things that don't. And you have now Blanchfield at -390. And for me, that's good enough for me. I'm going to take Molly McCann +320. I'm not greedy. I don't want to play her. I probably should play her inside the distance. But quite honestly, if I'm really greedy, if she gets the KO, I kind of want to flex a little bit, you know, but I'm not confident enough to do that. So I'm going to play Molly McCann +320. And yeah, it's certainly possible that the first narrative works, but that narrative is -390. Narrative I spun is +320. And I think just as likely. Anyway, so that looks like a loss. Moving on. Dominic Reyes against Ryan Spann. So this is one of this is another fight where this is like there are two fights kind of like this. And I'm gonna treat them both the same. Actually, I'm not treating the same. Dominic Reyes against Ryan Spann. You have Dominic Reyes, who, well, let's just spin the narrative, right? First of all, he is let's pull the odds up. He is -210, Spann +180, and it's a finishing type of fight. You know, it's a -110 inside the distance. So it's a finishing type of fight. Let's put it that way. From both sides. So what's been baked into this line? So Dominic Reyes fought John Jones a couple of fights back. He was basically fast-tracked to that fight. He didn't really beat anybody that great leading up to that fight, but he had a very, very nice performance against John Jones, and he lost. Some people thought he won. Some people thought he got robbed, whatever it is. So in everybody's head, they were thinking, okay, so Dominic Reyes should be treated as someone who just beat John Jones, or at least was close. And it's possible. Then after that, he fought Yuri, whatever how you pronounce his last name. And they got into kind of a war for the first round, and he was doing okay. And then he got spinning elbowed and not senseless. Then the fight after that, he also, he got, wait, who did he fight in his last, the fight after that? He lost. So he's on a three fight losing streak. And the question is he quote unquote done? You know what I mean? Is he quote unquote done? And we'll get back to that. On the other hand, you have Ryan Spann, who is definitely lower level, and he's fought weaker competition. And he got knocked out by Anthony Smith. He did get a nice guillotine win over Kutalaba. And overall, he's kind of like that guy who's kind of like a front runner. You know, I think if he could either KO a guy or get KO'd or something like that. So I have to say that the majority of what I'm hearing is this kind of strength of schedule argument still. That Dominic Reyes, he's just fought, quote unquote, the better competition. And that if he can't beat Ryan Spann, I don't know what to tell you. Well, bottom line, in my view, is that he's got, let's look this up real quick. Because I, for some reason, forgot who Dominic Reyes fought in his last fight. So we're going to pull this up just soon. It's going to ruin me if I don't remember this. Oh, Blachowicz, right. Okay, so there's not any shame. In losing. Oh, what are all these other fights? Why are we missing a couple of them? Where's the John Jones slayer? I guess just don't have, maybe wasn't betting on it. I have no idea what this was. So against Blachowicz, he got dominated. Okay, he got knocked out by Yuri. There it is, Yuri. Right over here. They put these out of order for some reason. So it was the Blachowicz fight that I neglected. So it was Blachowicz first, then Yuri. Okay. So I feel as though that the majority of the narrative is on the Reyes side. And I will say this, that span at 180 just feels so uncomfortable. You know, like if you watch him fight, he just folds sometimes. And he got knocked out by Anthony Smith, who's not really a knockout guy, but he got submitted or whatever. So the plus 180 on span just feels so, so uncomfortable. So you know what? We're going to do it. Plus 180, Ryan Spann. 180 at 180. I mean, how does that lose, right? Okay. Moving on. Brad Riddell against Renato Moicano. This one's a tough one for me. You know, I don't know exactly where everything's leading because I'm hearing kind of narrative on both sides. I'm getting so Riddell is definitely the better striker. And Moicano, he is kind of getting this sort of this narrative going, he's got a bad chin. Okay. But on the other hand, you do have Moicano as the guy that's more likely to get takedowns and submissions and things like that. I think that in the end, there's no real psychology lean here. I think I'm getting enough people on both the Brad Riddell side and the Moicano side to make it not much of an edge. So I guess if there was one fight that I was not going to bet on, you know, that I really had no edge, no real feel for, it would probably be this one. But I'm going to pick something anyway. So let's just kind of take a look. Riddell by KO. That's something I didn't. Well, I get a little of that because the Moicano bad chin narrative. So you know what I'm going to do? Let's just do something. Let's just put fight goes to decision or something like that. So yeah. So let's just go. Fight goes decision plus, yeah, plus money, plus 120. So we'll do that. Fight goes decision plus 120. All right. And this is kind of a fun parlay, right? 9-pick parlay plus like 1 billion or something like that. Pretty fun. Okay. Moving on, we have. All right, this one's a lock. Right, this. Oh my God, this one is such a lock. You've got to be kidding me. All right, so Dan Hooker -150 against Claudio Puelles +130. It just literally doesn't get any easier than this, from a betting perspective at least. Okay. So Dan Hooker has been around. He's got incredible strength of schedule. He's fought the best, whatever it is. And Claudio Puelles has fought nobody, right? And you have this collision sometimes between fighters like this. You know, one guy's put in the work, maybe on the decline, maybe not. Then you have Puelles, who's like this kind of an up-and-coming guy. But this fight's different. You want to know why? Because I'm gonna tell you the narratives. Listen, there's no shame. Hooker, look, he got caught by Michael Chandler, right? Whatever. He got beat by Khabib. Everybody's going to get beat by Khabib. And look, Arnold Allen, he lost to him. He's going to be going, you know, fighting for a title soon. So there's no reason, there's no shame in losing to those three guys. And when he fought the next last reasonable guy, Hasperas, he totally dominated. Total masterclass. I mean, it's ridiculous. And if that's not even enough of it, if you do a YouTube search, you'll look for Volkanovski, who's literally the GOAT. Okay, he's he's my favorite fighter fighting right now. He actually broke down these fights. And you know what he said? He says, for those of you that are saying that Dan Hooker's done, you guys don't know what you're talking about. I actually sparred with him in preparation for my last fight, and he gave me some of the toughest rounds that I can imagine. You look it up. Look it up. And this fight, this is his words. This is a perfect fight for Hooker. But both of you think that Hooker's dead, you guys have no idea what you're talking about. This is easy. And then if you go through all the sharp players, all the MMA betting shows, this is what you're going to hear. Puelles, all he is knee bar or bust. That's all he is. He's has one move. He doesn't really have the greatest wrestling. And Hooker is so experienced, whatever. He's got to look for just one thing. He's going to piece him up on the feet. And this is basically a mismatch. Poilus has fought nobody. And he's only got one path to victory. I mean, this is a total mismatch. So I guess it should be Hooker minus 300. And it's only minus 150. I mean, I'm sorry. Poilus plus 130 is just going to be, this is what I call a sheets theoretical one. You know what I mean? Like, it's not, this is for me, like the easiest play on the board. Now, do I want to get greedy? Now, if I really want to get greedy, you know how I play this. It would actually be like not Poilus by submission, because that's what everybody's expecting from his win. I would say maybe Poilus by decision. Let's take a look at that. Take a look at that stuff. But Poilus by decision. Ooh, 650. Oh, my, oh, my. Now, there's no way that I can do that. I mean, I could. But we're just going to play him plus the 130. You want to know, because that feels like so dirty to play him at only plus 130. That it just has to. All right. If you haven't fired me yet, I mean, if you deal with this type of analysis and you're still around, well, I got other stuff for you coming. So now you get Frankie Edgar versus Chris Gutierrez. All right, so here's one thing I will say for sure, is that if you bet Gutierrez inside the distance, if you bet Gutierrez by decision, or you bet Gutierrez just and hope he gets a decision, You're in the wrong gym. Okay. Like Frankie Edgar is like the most famous, the most loved man in New York. And this is his last fight. If this is even remotely close, there's literally no chance Gutierrez gets the win. So you'd like to think that Gutierrez knows this and is going to really be aggressive and try for the K. What I'm hearing is that, again, that Edgar has, you know, he's has takedown upside. He's still a good wrestler. That's his path to victory. And everybody really wants to take that last shot on Edgar. I will add, though, that Edgar, his takedowns in his last fight was against Marlon Vera, who doesn't mind every once in a while getting taken down. And I'm not going to go with the Edgar wrestling narrative. I'm not going to go, by the way, with the fixed fight, get in the decision narrative also. What I think I am going to do is kind of fade all that and do the real uncomfortable thing. You know what that's going to be? I'm going to play actually Gutierrez by decision. I think that, again, that's asking for it, right? Because if it's close, they're going to give it to Edgar. So I have to feel as though somewhere, somehow in this line, that's got to be kind of factored in a little bit. So I'm going to go with Gutierrez by decision at a plus 150. Okay. Three fights left. You have, where is it? Dustin Poirier versus Michael Chandler. So this is one of my favorite things to do. So this is what we got. These guys are both real action fighters. I mean, they're really, really good. They really bring it. I don't care what anybody says about what fight IQ is needed to win this. These guys are both going to come out freaking attacking. All right. That's one thing I do know. Well, here's the deal. You have this fight, which was originally conceived as a 5-round fight, and now it is a 3-round. And I do think that helps the Chandler side a little bit. I do think that over 5 rounds, you would think that Chandler would rate to gas a little more. But I actually did wish it were 5 rounds, because if it were 5 rounds, I would bet Chandler. You know, because I don't know, you guys have heard my thoughts on this gassing in 3 rounds versus 5 rounds things. I think it's a lot of it is a bunch of unproven narrative. But we'll get into that next time we have the opportunity. This is what I'll say. is that when this fight was supposed to be five rounds, you had Poirier at plus 160, at minus 160. And now that it's been moved to three rounds, Dustin Poirier is minus 215. That's good enough for me. I'm going to take Chandler plus the 185. It's, again, I'm just glad that no one's talked about this, really. I'm glad no one's talked about this line move, because if that were the case, then I probably would get off it. But I think the majority of what's known about this fight is being priced in. But I'll tell you what I am going to do. And this is, again, you want to be contrarian? I am going to say that the majority of people think that if Chandler wins, it's going to be early. And then even though it's only three rounds, he's more likely to gas in the last round or two. So I think that Chandler by decision is interesting. So I'm going to think about this in general. So if like Chandler by decision, what odds do I need to do that? Probably plus 500. So let's just take a look at it. Chandler by decision is plus 600. So I think that's going to be good enough. And I think that Chandler, we've heard about this. Like, he does have the wrestling to make this work. And however, he's got this ego that doesn't want to go for it unless he has to. But I don't know. It's either Chandler by decision or Chandler just himself. So I'm going to go with, we played a lot of big underdogs here. But you know what? Let's go with, we're not playing Chandler by by KO or anything like that. I think that's kind of like what people are expecting. But then again, look at this. You have Chandler by TKO is almost the same as by decision. I don't get that at all. Is this going to be my sucker bet to play Chandler by KO? Because that's what people want to play, right? Or don't they? All right, I'm officially confused. So when I'm officially confused, I'm just gonna play him plus the winning. I don't understand. So we're gonna fight line, Chandler plus 185, and that'll be the end of that. Okay. Moving on to two 5-round fights. You have Zhang Wei Li versus Carla Esparza, and this one is a little annoying. This is like the one spot where I don't think I have too much of an edge on this, because I think that every narrative is pretty well played out on both sides. You have this let's have some fun. Esparza just came off the most boring championship fight of all time, and she got booed out of the gym. Last time Wei Li fought at Madison Square Garden, she lost to Rose Namajunas in sort of a controversial decision. I was there. I thought Rose won. He's doing the truth. But nonetheless, Wei Li's been waiting for this to come back to Madison Square Garden. She's going to get cheered on, and Esparza is going to get booed all the way in. And you know what else? Like, Esparza's only path to victory is wrestling. She really has no striking. And Zhang Wei Li, you know what Zhang Wei Li does? She like picked up Francis Ngannou in some of these YouTube videos. And she is so big and so aggressive and so strong that Esparza is just not going to be able to keep her from getting KO'd in five rounds. You know, it's just not possible. How is she going to survive 25 minutes? She's going to basically have to out-wrestle Zhang Wei Li for 25 minutes and control her and not let her get all these shots in to have a chance. So it seems easy, right? You take Zhang Wei Li inside the distance. What's that price? Zhang Wei Li inside the distance is plus 120 to win by TKO. Just, you know what I mean? Like, so listen, life is not that easy. Zhang Wei Li is not a minus 800. So I do think that Carla Esparza is kind of live here. The problem is that, you know what other people are also saying? They're saying, how can you give the champ plus 270. And that narrative sucks. It's a really bad one. And if you fade that narrative, you usually win. So I think that narrative street is basically closed for business. I think that they've all been kind of played out. So what I have to do is just go with the most contrarian thing I can come up with, given everything I said. You know what that's going to be? That's going to be Zhang Wei Li by decision. So Zhang Wei Li by decision is a plus 200. I don't think anybody in their right mind is going to play this. So that's what we're going to do. Zhang Wei Li by decision, plus 180. For 180 plus 200. Okay, moving on, you have Israel Adesanya versus Alex Pereira. And so this is what you have. This is sometimes when the obvious becomes the unobvious. I'm pretty sure I know what I'm doing here. I mean, you have these two, and here's the narrative. These two fought when they were both kickboxers, like years ago. And Pereira knocked him out twice, right? Or did he get decision once? He beat him twice. Okay. So they've taken different paths to get to this point, right? Pereira's continued to do kickboxing until the last year. And Adesanya's went on to do MMA. And now they've gotten to this point. They knew that it was going to get to this point a year ago when Pereira decided to get into the MMA. They gave him a fight against Mikulaitis, which this was in Madison Square Garden a year ago. He gave up one takedown and a little control time in round one. Then he KO'd him round two. Then they gave him a fight against, I think it was Bruno Silva. Definitely a step up in competition. Competitive, but he got to him as well. Then in round, and his next fight, he was against Strickland, who they said that Strickland was going to wrestle him and this was going to be the end. No such luck. So we're at this point. Now, in the meanwhile, Israel Adesanya has been just basically winning every fight. And the thing is that he's been winning every fight against guys who had style clashes, right? He's always been really fighting guys who had more wrestling upside and things like that. And nobody could really compete with him as far as striking goes. So he's basically been able to wheel around the cage and do what he's got to do, right? So what I've been hearing is that, listen, kickboxing is not MMA. It's different. It's a smaller cage. It's all this. The gloves are different. And you just can't compare the two necessarily. What Izzy has done since he has come to MMA, he's refined his MMA game to a point where he knows the octagon, he knows the geography, and you just can't compare apples to oranges. And, you know, it's just Izzy's fight to lose. This is his legacy and all of this stuff. So of course, what are we going to do? We're going to play Pereira. And the only thing that I want to do is figure out whether I want to play him by KO or by decision. Playing him by decision is certainly contrarian, but I just feel as though that in the end, where Adesanya could win a really boring fight by wheeling around the octagon for 25 minutes. Something about it, man. He's at MSG. He's going to want to put on a show if he can. These fighters have egos. I think it's going to get to him, and I think he's going to end up standing and trading and getting clipped. So I am going to be taking either just Pereira or Pereira inside the distance. So let's take a look and see what these odds are. Pereira. He's either plus 180 or him by KO plus 300. What does a decision look like? Yeah, I don't like the decision one. So I'm just going to play him. Oh, excuse me. He's plus, this is really all, not all you need to know. Yeah. Pereira is plus 275. He's more likely to get a KO than Izzy is. Boy, Pereira by decision is plus 850. I'll tell you this. That's pretty, I don't know, man. That's such a big gap between him winning by TKO 277 and decision 850. I guess I'll leave this one to you. Nah, you know what? I'm gonna take. Well, which is gonna be KO or decision or just the 180? I guess the 180. I guess it depends how much I'm losing for the night, right? I'm losing by a lot, I'll have to take one of these others. So for now, we're just gonna put him at plus 180, and then we'll just move on. So we are not playing the 14 pick parlay. But we're going to play all these. So let's just review everything. Ulberg in round one, plus 300. RSA by decision, plus 300. Trezano, straight money line, plus 145. Kovalkiewicz, minus 110. Frivola, plus 130. Petroski by decision, plus 330. Molly McCann, plus 320. Span, plus 180. Riddell Meccano to go the distance, plus 120. Huelles, plus 130. Gutierrez to win by decision, plus 150. Chandler, straight up, plus 185. Zhang Wei lead by decision, plus 200. And Alex Pereira, plus 180. And so we're going to stake all singles. So 180 is going to be 25-20. That is what I'm going to be betting once I log off of this. And we will see what I cash out for. And hopefully this didn't, this wasn't too bizarre. But this is more in the same of what you'll be getting from me going forward. So good luck.